Hello friends, so today in our series Breaking the Horizon, I welcome you all. And in this 7 steps for venturing into dairy sector series, today we are going to release episode 5. Now this episode talks about role of technology and funding. Most of the time we consider both of these terms like technology and funding in different silos. But in reality, both of them have a very strong connection. In today's episode, I would like to tell you the significant areas of interface of these two important terms. The agenda of this episode is going to cover, first of all, what is technology? Let's try to understand what technology is all about. Because whenever I talk to any dairy startup or when they talk to me, everyone is talking about that I want the high-tech farm, I want the best technology, I want the automation and those kind of terms. So let us understand what does this technology and this high-tech means. And then what is the role of technology in a dairy startup? That is the second most important thing which we need to cover. We'll be looking this technology part in a dairy farm, in milk procurement, at milk processing plants. We will be touching upon some areas of sales and distribution also. And then we will be covering two important areas of what is the expectation of investors from startups. And then lastly, how selection of technology improves chances of funding. So that is where we will be concluding the episode. Now first, let us understand what is technology. There are various definitions of technology being given by so many people since ages. But I think if we look today, then the kind of technology which is making waves and which you find everywhere. So the definition given by Matt was technology is best when it brings people together. So the first role of technology is definitely at the back end to create a seamless stream of communication and bringing people together. But from the context of, let us say, a dairy startup or for manufacturing or services sector, the definition which I like the most is technology is of no use if it doesn't provide a cost-effective solution to produce products and services for the masses. So now what we have to look at, that whenever anyone is talking of the technology, you know, being there in their machineries or supplies or services, then you have to weigh it on two platforms. Number one, is that technology providing a cost-effective solution? In the sense, does it reduces your cost anywhere by using that technology? And even if suppose it is incurring some cost, then in that particular case, the solution, if scaled up, so should have a scaling up capability, if scaled up, then at masses, it will be able to provide the products and services at the least cost. So you have to look at it at the technology, the available technologies from this perspective. And this definition was given by none other than Jeff Immelt, who took over as chairman and CEO of GE in 2001. He took the baton from Jack Welch, who is supposed to be one of the first superstar CEO in any industry in the world. Now let's look at the role of technology from dairy perspective. Now, whenever we are talking, most of these things are applicable to other industries also. But I would like to share my thoughts on what is the role of, the way we look at the role of technology in dairy startups. And this is the way when we mentor, you know, startups with us. So we make it very clear to them that when they are going for selection of technology, at that time they have to keep these points in their minds. And later on we handhold them, you know, for choosing the right technology. First thing is, technology should be such which should save on time. So when I say save on time, in that particular case, most of the time we have a feeling that being there on the floor, being there in the manufacturing area, actually that is what is the core of business. I feel that in today's time, if you are working in dairy, whether it is farm or whether it is processing plant, the most important part is to spend more time at your vendor's interface, be it at the one from where you are getting the milk or feed or fodder or animals or technology, or to be there in touch with people who are consuming your product, distributing your product, your retailer, your dealer, your distributor, your final consumer. So when it comes to the role of technology, so you have to decide in such a manner so that at the farm level and at the plant level, whatever technology you are going in for, it is saving on time. So you should look for comparatively slightly higher capacities than opting for very low capacities. For example, when people talk of 1,000-2,000 liter plant, I would suggest go for a, even for a 1,000 liter per day plant, go for a 1,000 liter per hour kind of a processing line. Reason being, spend least of the time at the manufacturing. By going for a 200 liter per hour line, which so many people are selling right now in the marketplace, by going for such kind of plants, you will be spending or you will be wasting whole of your day with that technology, and you will be having least of time to go at the interface of market or at the people who are supplying you milk. The second important thing is saving on cost. It does not matter much, you know, initially in your capital expenditure, if it is going 10, 15, 20% up or down. Because if your technology is relevant, in that particular case, your project report or your business plan will be justifying it somewhere in the technology rationale, which we normally prepare for every project what we do for our clients. So in that technology rationale, those things will be covered up. Don't be very much afraid of that capex going up in the initial phases. Look for what it is going to save you in terms of your recurring cost. So look for technologies which can save on cost over a period of time instead of saving capital expenditure at this stage. Saving on effort. Look for those technologies which reduces the efforts to carry out the same thing. So it may be reduction of efforts, let's say maybe inclusion of more of conveyors, inclusion of some kind of lifters, trolleys inside the system. So those are also part of technology. We can't ignore them. So reduce as much of efforts as possible, going vertical way, putting dumb waiters. So have such kind of provisions in your area. Bring in those kind of technology which are saving on efforts. Then definitely, from funding investor point of view also, anything which helps you in food safety, in creating and delivering food safety to your end consumer, must be taken care of. Be it through your hygiene station technology being used for creating hygiene, maintaining hygiene, or be it through your testing facility or technology for, let us say, quality control. Helping in value addition. Always look for those technology which can help you convert your product into high value product. That high value could be in the form of varieties, could be in the form of nutrition, could be in the form of shelf life, could be in the form of more relevant to a particular customer group. So like what we have discussed in earlier episodes on opportunities, so you can very well check it out that, go for those technologies which are relevant in current times, which is helping in better positioning. So as I was mentioning that you should have some patented or specific technology so that somewhere when you are selling your product at that time, you can say that yes, your technology which you are using is patented, and that is why it is giving a specialized kind of a product. For example, HPP technology right now without doing anything, without any heating, by preserving, let's say, the nutritional value. Same is true with, let's say, freeze drying. So using those kind of technologies, you are maintaining the nutrition and extending the shelf life and helping the product to be kept at, let's say, room temperature. So maybe where you know you can have a better positioning and higher value addition potential, you must look for those opportunities. Reducing time to market. This is another important thing, that your technology should be such that as against the competition, you should be in a position to make your product reach to the market faster. It could be done by, it all depends, you know, how you handle the technology. For example, you are getting milk from far off places. In that particular case, instead of setting up only chilling centers, if suppose you set up some kind of milk condensing facility, so then what is happening as against, let's say, 3 road milk tankers, one tanker of that evaporated milk is coming to you. So that way what you are doing, you have reduced the complete time, you know, being taken up, and reduced the risk also for product reaching at your site safe. So you can think of such kind of thing, that how to use the systems. Maybe in logistics also you can have some kind of technology of tracking, which we'll be discussing maybe later on. Then you have to look for helping in expanding outreach. So that is only possible if you go for working on the shelf life of the product. So by working on the shelf life, if suppose everyone is giving 3 days shelf life, if your case is 5 days, so maybe you get another 50, 100, 200 kilometers to move on. If everyone is giving, let's say, 15 days of shelf life, if you work with something like 21 days or 90 days, in that particular case, maybe you can go to all parts of the country. And if it is beyond 90 days, then you can go to all parts of the world. So that is how you have to look at that, how to expand your outreach. Helping in traceability from farm to table. The digital connectivity in the data flow, in the data management. This particular thing is going to play an important role. So from farm to table, right from the first place, from the farmer's house till the last consumer, you need to create a system of highest level of traceability, because these are the context of today's business. So in that particular case, all the investors will feel very happy to invest in you in case you have taken care of or you have chosen the technologies which can deliver all these points. Now let us look at what kind of technology which could be used in a dairy farm. Now let us look at a cow. So cow is considered to be a perfect natural fermenter. You know, you won't be getting a better fermenter in the world which gets fed with, let's say, grass, and then which delivers, let us say, milk, manure and urine. And urine also, as someone says, that it has some therapeutic value. Whatever that that call is from the market side or from the people who are promoting it, but still you are getting, you know, these kind of refined products from grass itself. So what to focus as far as the technology that dairy farms are concerned? So first thing is, as we normally say, if you look dairy farm from genetic perspective, then it is all about breeding, breeding, breeding. If we look at a dairy farm from nutrition perspective, then in that particular case, it is feeding, feeding, feeding. And if we look from animal husbandry perspective, then it is resting, resting, resting. So that way, if I combined all these things put together, then in reality, if I want to achieve the best of genetics, the best of nutrition, the best of animal husbandry, then I call it as recording, recording, recording. So start looking for all those technologies where you can capture the data. It means where you can do right kind of readings. So reading on the genetics part, when the cow is in heat, when is the right time for insemination. On similar levels, what is the level of productivity which we are getting, relating it to the genetics. Similarly, what is the productivity relating it to the nutrition? So you should have some kind of softwares, some kind of mechanical mixing management where you can get best conversion of feed into milk, best level of palatability and simultaneously recording also. Then you need to have the best milk harvesting system where without impacting the animal, even the last drop of milk is stripped in a very comfortable position. And then last but not the least, how to maintain the comfort at the farm level, be it through cow brushes, how to maintain cleanliness at the farm and making some alternative income with the cow waste, maybe the manure management part of it, the biogas, the vermicomposting, those kind of technologies. So at farm, everything, you know, whatever can bring in the best of genetics, the best of comfort, the best of waste management, the best of milk harvesting, the best of nutrition, I would rather say, look at all those areas and go for relevant technology. Definitely a cost benefit analysis is to be done because all the technologies cannot be implemented at all scales of farms. So we will have to relate it to what scale of farm do we have, how, what is the number of animals. So we have developed tools for that over a period of time. So whenever someone comes to us, so in that particular case, we tell them with through those tools that which technology to be chosen, you know, at what scale of your farm. Now let us go further. So now that everyone doesn't have a farm, but yes, there is a milk collection system also. So today we have to look at it, all kind of possible interventions which can be done at milk collection center as well as chilling center. It could be done in the format which is more conducive from managing and let's say rating your cattle, the farmers. You have to look at the complete models which can support the small and marginal farmers from where you are collecting the milk on all aspects of dairy farming as being done by the commercial dairy farmer. So we can have, let's say, grading of milk being done. We can rate farmers in terms of the quality of milk which they produce, protein which is there in the milk, somatic cell count which is there in the milk, the level of safe milk which they are producing, how free is their milk from contaminants like antibiotics and aflatoxins. And then accordingly, we can create pricing model, and the technology is there. Digital technologies are available which can do it outrightly. We can also do something for cattle where we can look for thermal imaging of cattle or imaging of cattle like biometrics kind of thing. We can do prognosis on cattle where we can come to know about when and what is going to happen to the cattle with the little instruments related to activity monitoring being used on cattle. You can monitor all the activity, and again you can be preemptive on what kind of days, what kind of calving, what kind of health the animal is going to show in future. So there are so many things, you know, which can be done, and in that, over and above, you know, the testing milk for fat, SNF, adulterants, contaminants. There are rapid testing systems. Couple of them could be employed at village level centers. Couple of them may be required at chilling center because cost of testing has to somewhere be limited to a certain level, even for the best graded milk. So an appropriate kind of model could be created, and we have some standard models based on the capacity of milk to be collected, which we can very well implement at the client site. Now from here, the milk which is coming to the processing plant, then let's look at the kind of technology being required at milk processing plants. So the first thing which we see in technology part, the decision to be taken up at a milk processing plant starts with whether to go for batch process or continuous process. So at smaller capacity, batch process does wonders. In certain products where the volumes are low, batch product capacities does the wonder. In certain products, indigenous products, where yet automation has not come to that extent, maybe paneer making, maybe conventional ghee making, where aroma, body plays an important role, khoa making, barfi making, rasgulla making. Though people have tried automation also in the same, like continuous methods, and with automation something has been tried. But then at marketplace at times, perceptually those products are not getting accepted at the marketplace. But still, slowly and steadily, with people coming in large scale in the making of sweets and such indigenous milk products, probably over a period of time, these continuous lines will also be able to deliver consistent product being liked by the market. Then manual versus automation. Now everyone is talking of automation now, and I always suggest that look for all the time, keep on doing some cost benefit analysis on what is the benefit of going for automation, what kind of labor, or as I told you earlier, saving on efforts and saving on cost. So in that particular case, what kind of costs are getting reduced by going through automation? But it has also to be seen from the perspective of what kind of risk do you have by not making system automated from food safety perspective. So at all critical areas, go for automation. And that is why since quite a long time now, we have stopped giving any kind of systems, particularly in pasteurization, which is not having automatic FTV. So we adopted it maybe 15 years back, maybe 20 years back, because in early times only we learned that we can be quite cost effective by giving manual or semi-automatic kind of systems. But when it comes to food safety, at that time we can't rely on the human, and human error can lead to some kind of later on food safety issues with the product. And nowadays, let me tell you, this automation systems, their cost have reduced drastically down. So all the time look for the possibilities and spend a little more with this automation. Analogs versus digital. Now when you are thinking of continuous things, when you are thinking of automation method, then you are only left with digitalization of the complete process. And now these systems are also pretty economical nowadays. So having the best part with changing all your data processing, data capturing in digital is that you can store it somewhere. You can bring it to your system. By using certain apps, you can access your plant, your processes from anywhere in the world. So I think digital is the new normal now. Important thing to be seen today in technology part is that shifting your products from fresh category to extended shelf life to long shelf life. So look for those technologies which are giving you some kind of extension of shelf life of any of your products. The reason being, as I told you earlier, that look for opportunities where your outreach could be improved. So with better shelf life product, you are giving your customer more assurance of good quality product, even if the customer is unable to consume it in time. Simultaneously, it is also giving you an opportunity to extend your market horizon. And as this whole program is about breaking the horizon, using technology, or technology could be a very strong tool breaking that horizon. You can also start looking from large versus small packaging. Nowadays, everything is shifting to unitary packaging. Earlier, we used to have milk in 1 liter, then half liter, then 200 ml. Now, even up to 110 ml milk is being sold. You can go for unitary packaging of 2 gulab jamun, 1 gulab jamun, 1 barfi, 2 rasgulla, whatever way you want to have it. So look for smaller and smaller pack size, because this can also be aligned to your marketing strategy. So the startups whom we mentor, we also give them guidance on, depending on the market requirements, in which categories, what kind of unitary packaging you know, can really create a difference. Over and above the technology from the plant, machinery, processing, packaging, you also need to look at the utility. Go for cost-effective utilities. So be it your boiler, what kind of fuel is to be used. So we do a kind of cost comparison of different kind of fuels based on your capacity of plant. So that way choose the utilities, maybe the capex may be high initially, but later on your recurring cost will be very low. And lastly, the environmental friendly technologies. This could begin with the, going for an effluent treatment plant, which could be package based, which could be done with any kind of capacity of a plant. Simultaneously, you can look for those technologies also where, you know, even your packaging, which may be biodegradable or in that category. So you should start, because nowadays this is an in thing, and even investors are very much interested if you are opting for such kind of technology which are environment saving. Last but not the least, go for technologies which are most hygiene providing and which takes care of food safety. At times we find some similar, because people come to us and they say there are so many manufacturers making mini dairy plants ranging from, let's say, peanut pricing to any kind of pricing. So they say that, shall we go for that machine or not? My question most of the time remains as that maybe technically the products might be similar, but when it comes to the hygiene, when it comes to delivering food safety, then probably such kind of technologies might be compromised somewhere, might be negotiated somewhere. I'm not doubting anybody's technology, but I'm saying it is better to trust but verify. So we have ways in which we can test any technology, and we can give our comment on whatever you are purchasing. We can comment on whether that technology is right for you or not from hygiene and safety perspective. Now the next thing from the processing plant. Now dairy is no more a product business. It's more like a supply chain. And with Corona, as I have mentioned earlier in earlier episodes also, that it is more of a supply chain where you have to look of collection of milk in a stipulated period, making it reach the plant as early as possible, and then making it reach to the consumer as early as possible and as directly at his home as possible. So from that perspective, we have to look at the technology in supply chain. It could be, you know, the use of digital marketing and working directly with your customer base or target, apps for transaction interface, that is by giving control to your customers, e-commerce, another area, another channel to work on, cold chain monitoring, it could be done by using some kind of data capturing instrument for temperature or how many times the door got opened and all that on your vehicles. Then transport GPS tracing could be done, so you should know that where your vehicle is, how much time is supposed to take, where he's stopping more, and you can go for reasoning for that. You can go for route optimization software also, where looking at your warehouses, looking at your vehicle position, looking at the storage and inventories at different level, you know, the newer routes could be formulated. And then maybe even, you know, instead of giving fresh delivery, you can lift the products which are nearing expiry to the similar kind of area if that is being demanded in that area under exigency. So all those kind of things can now be very well formulated using IT. You can go for real-time customer service also. So it's now the time has again come that no robo will work, no Siri will work, no Alexa will work when it comes to the customer problem. So customer wants to talk to someone real. So have that kind of thing, use those kind of technology. And then lastly, the technology which could really give you traceability, because traceability is going to be the critical success factor in times to come. This will be the most important area where, you know, a competitive domain can be created and a competitive advantage can be created. because very strictly the regulator has brought in the concept of recall, and maybe right now it may be for 24 hours, but I think sooner or later, within 8 hours time, you should be in a position to trace back each and every material lying in the marketplace, and you should be in a position to recall that. Now let's come to the most important part at the end. What is the expectation of investors from DEDS startups? So I think there are a couple of things which we have learned by talking to multiple investors and funding agency, and by talking to startups who have got some funding. So in general, couple of them are related to DEDS, but couple of them are quite generic by nature. First thing, first and foremost, is your product breaking the sameness? That is the most important part. So it is not just another milk, it is not just another paneer, it is just not another, let's say, butter. And as I mentioned to you earlier, you have to be innovative, you have to look at the emerging trends. So you have to break the sameness. And for that, we have our own new product development center where we support startups to come out with something innovative, something creative, some kind of opportunity to break the sameness. Now, other important point is don't talk of USP too much. So nobody is going for USP like this is my unique selling proposition. The time has changed. It's more of a unique buyer requirement. So if your USP is that you are giving a high protein product, the important part over here is not USP that you are selling high protein product. The important thing is, does your buyer actually require high protein? So that is a big question. What kind of protein does he require? What is the specific protein requirement of your buyer? Because protein consumption stipulated from anywhere from 0.8 gram per kg of body weight to 2 gram per kg of body weight, depending on what kind of work you do. So don't just start loving your story. As I mentioned to you in the last episode of shaping the idea, don't love your story. First of all, understand what the customer requires and then start building a story. Living target and not virtual. This is also what we discussed in the last episode, that the investor is interested in seeing the real picture, not something which will be created after some time. So you can't bank a particular product idea based on the kind of population which is emerging or kind of segments which are emerging. No, he is interested in today, how many people are there living who are ready to pay for your product and service. So they are not talking of any species which will come up in future. So don't work on those kind of numbers that by 2025, this particular generation will start evolving and by 2030, they will become 1 million. No, nothing of that sort. No generation story, real time story, who are living right now. Future cash flows. That is the most important thing. So whether you are having a small customer base willing and repeatedly buying your product, that is very good. That is fantastic. Don't worry about it if the size is small. But what the investor looks is how this particular small size is going to evolve into a large population later on. So you should have some real kind of numbers, real time kind of projections, which you can really create. And your forecast should be as close to reality as possible. And for that, we have certain tools like opportunity mapping metrics where we can really do forecasting with the emerging targets, and that is how we support, you know, the clients at the time of mentorship. Then future customer base with growth potential, as I mentioned to you, which will be delivering the future cash flows. Highest level of compliance. So in that particular case, all the time keep one thing at the back of your mind. Have you done your homework well in terms of the kind of compliance required for this startup? Most of the time, the startup who fails to get proper funding, most of the time, the reason is not that their idea was not very good. The reason was that maybe on compliance, those people were failing miserably. They missed out on certain very critical kind of areas where compliance is required. Then be it the environment part, be it the FSSAI part, be it the taxation or let's say the boiler part. So you have to look at compliance from in a holistic manner. Finally, they would love the kind of system and technology which could ensure safe and quality product. Saying my milk doesn't have let us say aflatoxin or antibiotic is one thing, but saying it with proper documentation and a proper validation system is another thing. The investor will be watching, will be marking all your words, and he'll be verifying it. So have systems, you know, which can ensure safety and quality of product. Then definitely the technology must have opportunities for scaling and expansion, both. Expansion may be in other target categories also, but scaling is a must. So even if you are starting small, the model should be modular, or you should be ready with a plan B or what will happen. Because most of the time, as I normally say, never try to prepare for failure only, prepare for success also. And that is what most of the time people fail. They fail to prepare themselves for success. And most of the time they are successful in preparing themselves for failure. Now this is a paradox. I have seen more entrepreneur in my lifetime failing because they couldn't handle the expansion than the entrepreneur who failed because the market was contracting somewhere. No. So look at it from that perspective. You have to prepare yourself for success. So look for how the scaling and expansion will take place. Numbers must speak. You must be very good at numbers, and your numbers must speak. So it's just not jugglery. It's validating each and every number, visiting each and every number, and having reason for each and every number. Even if on your Excel sheet there are 100 cells which are filled up, try to have notes on each and every step, on each and every cell. So that is what will make your story more, I would rather say, more authentic for the investor. And lastly, the investor looks at your risk-taking capacity. So don't just go for cheaper technologies, cheaper manufacturers, the people who are, who can provide you all kind of things. Nothing of that sort. Have a specialized kind of structure in the technology being chosen. Go for high-end technologies. The investor should get you should be perceived as a person, even instead of having so many challenges, who is actually taking risk, who is actually believing in himself and his idea, and who is actually investing in the technologies of tomorrow. So you have to fulfill these requirements of the investors and funding agencies. And at the end, I would just like to advise you one thing, that please, the whole story should be such that it should be visible that you have put your skin in the game. And the example which I always share, so which there is a Santa Banta joke on that also. So Santa is asking Banta, what are you trying to do? So Banta is saying, trying to commit suicide. Then Santa asks, then why are you tying the rope around your waist? So Banta says, the last time I tied it around my neck, I nearly died. So please don't tie the rope around your waist. You know where it suffocates. You know where it is difficult. Take a tougher route. All the best to all of you. And please come back to me with your kind of queries or whatever you want to do. Share it with us. And anytime, contact us for daily mentorship for your dream projects. We are always available. But before that, you can have some discussions with me by first sharing your idea, and you can have my comments also. Thank you very much.